Has been an opportunity to live out every single childhood fantasy.
Rock and roll is kind of the fountain of youth.
I know certain things I'll be saying in this interview will probably piss some of my band members off.
You know what's going on all the time.
Get a watchful eye.
But I live in fear of weird things, and I'm convinced that bad things will happen.
I don't know what to tell you. I can't do this anymore. That's it. The band is over.
She's the blade.
When you get older, you owe me a vodka tonic and tickets to a Green Day concert, okay?
She's the blade and you're just paper. She's the blade and you're
Let's
just
do that.
You want to ask her if she can be on the DVD?
Sure.
Go chase her down.
I don't know if the camera should be on for this.
I need a ticket.
I'm not gonna cry. I'm not gonna cry.
We're Sugarcoat.
Dude, are you fucking for real?
Everybody's talking about blowing up the neighborhood. Everybody's gonna break it up today. Everybody's talking about blowing up the neighborhood.
I can't do it. I feel sad.
Stuck in America.
Hi.
Ciao.
Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Stuck in America.
We are going psycho.
Nice.
It feels like our band got taken to the proverbial next level. What a wild ride. The last 2 years have probably been the most dynamic. It's been a crazy chapter in the Sugarcoat story. I feel like we've grown a lot as a band.
Palm Trees and Power Lines was a record which reflected this huge gap of time between Start Static and Palm Trees. We had done a bunch of touring, a bunch of shit happened internally with the band. You know, I felt like it was a really personal, dark record. I started getting on medication when I was on Start Static because I was having anxiety attacks that were scaring the shit out of me. There's times where I thought I was having a heart attack. I couldn't get out of my rut, and it was the only way I could have any kind of sense of relief or peace was writing songs, then having others go, oh my gosh, I feel that way too.
You know, a good artist is going to write about their life experiences. And some songwriters can't communicate their emotions any other way. And I wouldn't say Tim's like that, but I have worked with people that basically are unable to deal with certain things in their lives, and so that's how they deal with it. They write songs about it.
The more other people can relate to some of the oddities that go on in your brain, the more of a kind of gravity you feel with yourself.
You know, music is just, it's like a snapshot of an artist at that period in time. And then, you know, they change. Artists change all the time.
There were some songs about some relationships that didn't turn out the way that I had hoped. There's a song about our old drummer Ben on the record called Champagne. It kind of reflected a period of time when he had to leave the tour early and go to rehab for drinking.
Champagne, day after day down the drain, sleeping around.
seeds of it were planted along the way, and some of those seeds sprouted, grew into things that became reasons we might not be able to continue on as a band anymore. The only time that I think it's even appropriate to make any big changes, if ever, is in between records. Somebody needed to be taken out of the chemical equation in order for it to not implode.
Action tour for 6 weeks with early November, Hawthorne Heights, a bunch of bands. It's like a suicide prevention tour, which raises money for a nonprofit organization that provides like suicide hotlines for kids to call if they're feeling depressed. It's a good thing to be a part of. It makes me feel good.
Hey, long way from sunny California.
We're in Big Flake, Virginia. Richmond.
Think anybody's gonna show tonight? For the show?
I hope so.
They're not a bunch of sissies that can't handle the snow.
It's gonna be a big slushy out there. We should go get some, you know, at the grocery store where they have that, like, Italian ice juice.
Yeah.
We'll just go out into the parking lot and scrape up some gray ice. Sell it to kids in the line.
Yeah. Aaron is an unbelievable bass player. He has an unbelievable ear for pitch and tune and sense of melody.
Aaron. That's A-I-R-I-N. That's the way he spells it. He's a bird of a different feather.
My role in the band is that I sing harmonies, play bass, shut the f*** up.
Aaron's a different person now than back then. When I first met him, he seemed so innocent, and he had kind of long hair, and we were in a music class together. I was cheating off of him, and we just became friends. And Aaron is very textural. If I were to take the headphones out of his hands and put it up to my ears, it could just be a looped sound of crazy, just an orchestra of sounds and noises going on.
I like stuff that's more math. It's more technical. I mean, I like stuff that's immediate and poppy and catchy too.
His brain works like that, and I don't think it's chaos to him. I think it's really like, it's very beautiful to him.
I had my parka and I forgot that I had $1,000 in my pocket in medication. Before I left for tour, I had $1,000 under my bed. So I was like, I fucking need gas money. I'll just grab it. I had no idea.
That's so fucking funny.
That's the next record title right there. $1,000 and some medication.
If you guys need anything while you're here, I live here, so.
I need to go to Rite Aid to get, like, earplugs or, like, one of those kind of places, you know?
Yeah.
Life in a tour bus is really tight, small, it's pretty smelly, it's usually really dirty.
I'm very claustrophobic. We're in a bus, and we each have our own bunk, and it smells like 14 dudes went out, like, 2 hours ago, drank a fifth of gin, and then downed a pizza and didn't brush their teeth and all went to bed at the same time.
You cannot tour without having an air filter in your bunk. Otherwise, you wake up and all you smell are burps, farts, and feet.
It's unpleasant.
I take a pre-everything nap. If there's a chance to take a nap, I'm taking it. Clap or clap on, clap off.
So at night, you know, you find a place to shower.
See you in an hour.
A lot of venues have them, but they're broken.
Hot water doesn't work. Can't find a towel.
Oh, man. This sucks.
The shower's a bit sketchy, but any shower's a good shower, in my opinion.
And this four-inch snake attacked me in the middle of the shower, and the only way I could fight it was with the conditioner and choke it out. Sucks, dude.
You go to bed and you sleep on the bus and you drive all night and you're at the next place in the morning.
There buyouts or?
Yeah, actually I'm gonna give this one.
Sweet, dude, I love money.
What's up?
For dinner tonight, man. $2.50.
Whatever 10 bucks can buy you.
The cake incident. Kind of joked and called it the cake action tour. It was snowing really hard in Richmond and someone had said, we have a cake already and we want to bring the cake out on your stage and sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Brianna.
16th birthday.
Apparently the mom's like bringing the cake up
the steps to go onto the stage and she kind of missed one.
And this is so sad. Apparently she tripped, like totally stacked and dropped the cake and all the candles went out. She picked it up like nothing happened. I mean, I was like none the wiser. I was just playing my parts, and I look over and see, I noticed the cake looked a little lopsided, and I went ahead and like dug into that thing, man.
Marco ate the piece that like fell on the ground or something.
Dude, this cake is amazing.
Cake is always good, especially when it's got a broken guitar string remnants in it and various debris from the stage of a sweaty nightclub.
So we could eat some.
Tostada salad before sound check. That's the highlight of Charlotte, North Carolina today.
What's going on for lunch?
Mexican food.
Really?
Mexican food. Meal number two in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Marco is one of the best self-promoters I've ever met. Always got stickers in his back pocket. Every place that he's been, that he sees a space for a sticker, it's like a very creative mind.
I hollowed out the inside and I stuck a little iPod mini in it. So I just listened to like, you know, Bob Dylan the whole time while we're playing the show.
Marco brings such a unique element of style to our band and is so important to our fans and to us.
I'm a flirt. I'm a peacock. I'll be the first to admit that I put on some pretty wacky get-ups every once in a while, and I love it. It's part of my personal way of expressing myself. You are delivering your music. Put on the outfit that's gonna like take those songs to town and present them to the people that come to see us. I'm sentimental to a fault. I'm the guy in the band who I'm collecting, you know, mementos, clipping stuff out of the paper, collecting everything.
On many levels, he's just like a fan. He brings a lot of the communication with fans and reaching out to fans. He gets the fans, I think, better than any of us.
It's definitely good for the band.
Some of them are too great and want to know every little detail, like what my home address might be, my telephone number.
We don't make exclusive music. Our music is for everybody.
Oh, I'm excited about seeing you guys tonight. This is like the only band I came to see. My band has covered one of you guys' songs.
Really?
We've done Memory.
So. No way.
Yeah,
it's awesome.
Yeah,
you guys probably do it better than us.
Probably not. I'm Grant, by the way.
I'm Tim.
Yeah, I know you're Tim.
What our music means to you is more important than what it originally meant to us.
And that's why they like it, because it either reminds them of a certain time or they feel like it's, oh, that song's so about me. So that's how they become fans. It's not just because we're so good looking.
Does anybody have an extra ticket? No. I need a ticket.
Sweet.
None of us are each other's boss, so it's more like a family, you know?
Our band's always been a pretty good democracy, but I would say if someone was in the driver's seat, it would be Tim. And we all take turns riding shotgun, giving him directions.
You know, I am in a unique situation in this band because I write the basic blueprint, the structure of a song for the most part, you know, like what it's going to be about in a dynamic. I write the songs. I don't write the music because music is the whole thing. And I don't take credit for all the textures that they add.
Aaron, do you know how the rhythm goes on that outro part?
I don't know what you're cutting and what we're leaving in. Like, he doesn't know. He's just playing through it.
I just try to make the songs that he makes. If I have an idea, I'll show it to him. But if I told him to play my ideas, then it wouldn't be Sugar Cult.
I feel like he has good instincts. And there's things in the past that I would think, like, where are you coming from, dude?
You know, there's many times where I have a complete vision beginning to end for how I want something to sound. I hear guitar parts, I hear drum beats, I hear vocal harmonies. And when I do, I can be a really difficult motherfucker to work with.
Just go from the breakdown, do the two and out, and see how it goes.
Do it now. I don't even know what that means. I'll sing it the way I right.
Tim's meticulous. He's pretty meticulous. But I respect the fact that he really knows what he wants.
But I've learned to sometimes just go, okay, certain areas of the band, I'm gonna take a leap of faith here and just let Tim have his way and just go for it.
Uncle Dad says that I'm a good kisser. Whoa. I'll show you my favorite movie. Ready? Watch this. Tiger.
I can't top that.
I mean, I can fight you with that leg.
Kenny is one of the nicest people in the universe you'll ever meet. He's funny.
Sometimes you can walk into the most awkward situation and just like immediately start telling and cracking jokes and really loosen up a room.
But he has a set number of jokes.
Did I tell you about the three-legged dog that walked into the bar? I said, I'm looking for the man who shot my paw.
And so once you hear all of them, you start to predict what he's gonna say next.
When someone says something, I'll just like file it in my head. I'll be like, I bet you Kenny's gonna say this right now. And he'll say it, exactly.
How many people with ADD does it
take to change a light bulb?
I love chocolate.
I love chocolate.
I love chocolate.
I can't tell you how many times I heard that joke.
They're still funny though for some reason. And it's not the joke, it's the personality behind it.
Get the job done right, you bring the right tool. You know what I'm saying?
He also carries like a hatchet in his bunk in case he has to chop his way out of a bus.
I live in fear of weird things. And I'm convinced that bad things will happen. I have a hatchet because I have an extreme fear of large vehicles crashing. There's no escape hatch in this area. And if somehow these doors lodge and we can't get out, then I'm gonna have to chop us all out to safety.
I'd be worried that if the tour bus tumbled that you'd wake up with a hatchet in your forehead.
And now the people who have made fun of my hatchet will be saved last.
He's a pretty weird dude.
He'd be hacking through metal. Like, wouldn't a blowtorch be better?
Don't give Kenny any ideas about the blowtorch, okay? The hatchet under his pillow is enough.
No, this is mine.
You gotta turn the camera off for a second.
I've been here many, many times. That's actually a really cool record store across the street. It's called Independent Records.
Tim's personality, he's a funny individual. He's got the same twisted sense of humor that a lot of my friends have. He's definitely in the group that get all the awkward jokes that not all my friends get.
We've gone to strip clubs where the girls are as ugly as me.
He's just Tim, you have to meet him to know him. Definitely one of a kind.
It's pretty disgusting, dude.
Is it really that offensive?
I can smell it as I walk by.
Dude, are you fucking for real? There's what? Ice on my fucking show pants and they're frozen in this position.
I love being on tour. I don't ever really miss home that much. I just kind of assume an entirely new life when I'm out there.
I'm just doing my stage clothes because I was so sick this last week. I got a couple emails from some fans that said they got sick because I sweat on them.
All right. I'm going four eyes.
Ooh, that's got hair on it.
Aaron's definitely an observer.
You know what's going on all the time. Get a watchful eye.
Aaron is one of those guys that just doesn't give out the friendship card to everyone. He keeps it close to himself.
He's gonna get to know a few people really well.
I get a sense that Aaron struggles by being in a group when other people are a little more dominant and overpowering. Aaron will recluse to make himself be heard, if that makes any sense. Sometimes in a band, you know, that can be really unhealthy. And I just assume when someone gets really quiet that something's on their mind and they might be pissed off at me. It can be really frustrating. You have to pry, you have to investigate.
Maybe comes across to people as being shy, reserved, which if you get to know him as a person is not necessarily the case. He's a pretty honest dude.
Same chords throughout the whole fucking song and the same rhythms. I mean, I just need to know the arrangement.
If I have a strong opinion about something, that's when I do voice my opinion. It has more weight than if I'm always just, I think this. If you have too many people trying to run the show, you can have problems.
We are in Denver, Colorado. We're probably a little further than the halfway point in the Take Action Tour.
Wow.
Oh, hey, dude. You got some up dog on your flash right there. Some up dog. See the up dog?
What's that?
Huh?
What's that?
What's what?
Up dog, what's that? What's up, dog?
Yeah.
I don't know, dude, what's up, dog? Didn't really go over that well.
Marco is really outgoing. He's really artsy. He likes to read a lot. He's really interested in pop culture.
The moment of truth.
We got him both.
I used to work at a record store for a couple years, and I love people. I love meeting people. I love turning people on to music. It's a great job. I loved it.
He's like a music historian. He knows every little band and every date and who played what instrument and what band for the last 20 years.
This was the first record I ever bought with my own money. For those about to rock, we salute you. Good record.
Marco, more than anyone that I know, is a fan of music and music trivia and bands and wants to know about them.
You could pick out almost any CD right now and I would know something about it. Try it, try me. Wow. One of my favorite records of the early 90s, Jellyfish. Their keyboard player and co-songwriter now plays in Beck's band. Used to be in a band called Convoy. It was kind of a country-ish kind of band, and now they're doing this kind of David Bowie T-Rex kind of vibe, this kind of glam band called Louis the. He had to bring a few little party favors, if you know what I mean. This was the early 80s. It's kind of fun just walking through a record store and talking about music. All right, better get ready to play.
Hurry up!
A poor little unborn child spending all my money on food, the love food, records.
Oh, hurry up! Get dressed, dude.
What?
Let's go. How much? Like 10 minutes.
Thank you.
I'm assuming you're not going to ask any questions that would provoke me to say anything bad. One time I almost missed a show. It's a classic anecdote about how I passed out in one of the other band's rooms and their tour bus left and no one could find me. And I woke up nude on this bed. I didn't have a cell phone and I had just enough money to get there in cash, no ID. And it was just scary. I didn't know where I was. I almost cried. I ran across this parking lot and tried to rent a car with this mohawk just flopped over, reeking of alcohol, bloodshot eyes. I had a drinking problem. Basically, we'd get out there and, I think I just felt uncomfortable. And it was free. There was not much to do. Anyway, the drinking thing was bad for me.
Through the process of making Palm Trees and Power Lines, we needed to part ways with Ben, which was definitely not an easy, was not an easy adjustment for us at all.
That was awful. That was a shitty time for me. Because I really, really love Ben Davis.
It's a totally different band without Ben. I can't say who it affected more, but definitely affected everybody.
It just kind of breaks my heart. I mean, I didn't like being replaced.
At the time, it was such a dark period. I had such a hard time understanding an addictive personality.
Tim told me that he didn't want to work with me if I was drinking. That he couldn't bear to see it.
I couldn't deal with my own problems, and I certainly couldn't deal with ignoring his problems either.
He said that he has no patience and no sympathy for junkies because they're liars and they're always swearing to get better and then letting you down. There's so many intricacies of why. Tim said he thought it would be best that since things were going well and there's no animosity in the band, that it would be a good time to do a clean break, with a new record. I just don't like to fight, so. So I just accepted it, and that was the easiest way for me to deal with it. While I was in rehab, Kenny was touring with the band, and Tim was trying out his new ideas with Kenny.
Kenny brought something totally new and different to our band that seemed to complement the new types of songs I was writing.
While they were working on the new songs, I was working on my own things. I wasn't sitting around the house thinking, oh my God, I need to get down there. I need to be finding out what's going on with the new record. By not being present, that may have been a contributing factor to my being fired.
To me, I was a fan of the band, and Tim would come in with these ideas, and you just go, man, that's the music I like, and that's the music that I listen to.
And it just seemed kind of like, wow. Are we gonna make this record with Kenny?
It sounded like it was still Sugar Cult music. I listened to that record a lot. I thought it was great.
Got to a point where we were so proud of the record we made and felt like, God, this feels like a family again. And at that point, we pretty much made it official with Kenny. Like, hey man, do you wanna be our drummer? He's like, yeah. You know what I mean?
Kenny used to play in a band called Lefty. I used to watch Lefty all the time because I just thought Kenny played with so much attitude and hit the drums so hard. It was so heavy. It just sounded like someone fucking chopping wood or jackhammering a sidewalk apart.
He's the machine on those drums.
I approach drums as a sport, I guess. I just can't help but put all my energy into it. I can't go up and half-ass something. People are not gonna get their money's worth. I love playing drums, so to get up there and have as much fun as I possibly can is just what I'm there to do.
He's good.
He's crazy, he hits so hard. He's a monster.
I started out on guitar as a kid, and I threw my guitar out of frustration one day. I figured maybe I should beat things for a living, and that seemed to work out better.
Hope you're getting this on film, because someday I'm going to sell this for millions of dollars. How to sound really insanely good.
Kenny is the musician of the band that I think other musicians sit on the side of the stage and stroke themselves to.
I thought that's what I heard. I kept hearing this really loud whistling in my ear. I keep looking over there, but nothing's there.
You have your plugs?
Yeah, they're right
there. Wake up all alone, sending postcards. Something really, really awful happened with my ears. I've really bad tinnitus, and that's when your ears ring nonstop from being exposed to too much loud music, and I never ever wore earplugs. I couldn't sleep at night. I didn't know what the fuck was going on. My ears were just ringing loud 24 hours a day, nonstop. I'd wake up in the middle of the night, my ears would be screaming loud.
Tim thought he was going mad. He thought he was going insane because he always heard this weird buzzing in his head.
What happens is the cilia in your ear either bends over or breaks off, so it's always sending signal to your brain. So you hear that frequency. I'm sure it could be pretty nerve-wracking.
I called my band and my managers, and I said, I don't know what to tell you. I can't do this anymore. That's it. The band is over.
He really feared that the ringing in his ears could worsen, you know, through being on tour and playing shows and being exposed to loud music.
And they did a bunch of tests on my ears and found out that I fucked up my ears. Sign up. I remember like crying in the shower, just wondering what the fuck is going on. I was sitting there and I had this dilemma. Do I not do something that I love and that I'm passionate about and that totally fulfills me and something that I feel good about and good at doing and have that outweigh this problem?
Just made us have to rethink some stuff. Play acoustic instead of electric. Got in-ear monitors so we're not as loud on stage until he could get over the fear of damaging his hearing more.
And like Marco said, I fucked up my ears. All right, here we go, everybody.
It was a huge step, and it was a huge moment, and everyone was really happy, and I just took it show by show.
It was a challenge, it was an obstacle, he got around it pretty quickly.
All right, so far so good. Not deaf yet? Cross your fingers. Say your prayers.
The first time we played electric in like a month.
Here we go. I'm scared.
When I play live, I just always wear earplugs. I'm a huge backer of wearing earplugs and condoms. Earplugs in the ear, condoms on the finger. Get away, today I
changed. Turn the light down a little bit. Dude, I've been fucking spending way too much money so far on this tour. I'm just like buying rounds of drinks and compact discs. Nobody's business. And then we're going to a casino for the day off tomorrow. It's hard to resist. But, that's awesome.
How do I work this thing, dude?
Oh, man. Good whiskey.
Can there be two Marcos in Sugar Cult? I'm still not even sure if there can be one Marco in Sugar Cult. I'm such a pain in the ass.
Do you think this could be the question that you say, describe Marco, and I just smile to Kim like this?
It's my personality. I just can't not say something about something. I'm very like outspoken and stubborn about my opinions.
When he has a strong vision for something, you just have to get the fuck out of the way. He won't accept no. He won't understand what no is, or you won't understand why you don't see something his way.
Is he usually right?
I don't know, because we never do it his way at the end. I'm totally kidding.
Once in a while, me and Kenny fight like brothers.
Oh, you're trying to get me riled up, aren't you?
But we never do that.
Yeah, we do, dude. Come on.
Kenny's also pretty headstrong, too. Bullshit doesn't fly with him.
I'm the first to admit that I have many shortcomings.
Aaron and I have probably butt heads a lot in the past. I came into this band bass player. It's the language I understand the best. So when I hear a song, the first thing I hear is bass. I'm like, God, Aaron, maybe just, oh God, how do I say this to you? But is there any way you could just try it like this? And he'd be like, don't tell me what to do. What? You're not the bass player of this band. Well, okay, but I am a bass player, so maybe what I'm talking about has some, should have some something.
Well, it's kind of like a healthy battle. More than a fight, it's a discourse, a debate, usually. We get along great, too.
I can tell you that I've been in a lot of bands, and there's always been a Marco, there's always been a Tim, and there's always been an Aaron.
We all bring something different to the table. Sometimes Tim's innocence, having only been in one band, is what gets us to where we are, whereas my years and years and years of experience with different bands can just fog my vision and just make me think 10 different ways about things and not just be able to make a snap judgment and move forward. So that's where we balance each other out.
What were you guys just discussing?
How to be Van Halen with David Lee Roth, not with Gary Cherone. Oh, hold on for a second, it's Victoria and she's sick.
Hello?
March is the last month that I'm ever not gonna be a parent, because in April at some point we're gonna be parents. Hey, good night.
How are the teeth? Are they clean? No. I actually haven't brushed my teeth in, I'm going on day 3 now. Kind of a bummer because my friend Vanessa's coming today and I need to be in tip-top shape. That's why I'm busting out this shaver and why I'm kind of shaping up the mustache, because who can deny a man with a mustache? You know, kissing a man without a mustache is like eating an egg without salt.
What are you writing down?
My phone number. I just happen to have a pen right there.
So. Oh, okay. Well, here, let me put it in my telephone.
Like Tim, man, if you look through his phone, man, he has got so many different area codes with a female name attached to it. He loves the ladies.
Well, the light's hitting you really nicely. Look at that. You look angelic.
Oh, thanks.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
I want to chase those girls now.
Tim's weaknesses, women and women. Did I mention women?
It's gonna get ugly.
He's young and virile and single.
Can I use your body as a wonderland?
Sure.
How do you like my mustache?
It's disgusting.
Can you believe that? Disgusting was the word you used to describe my face.
You look like a chia pet. Sorry, Tim.
Sweet action. Looks like it's dinner for one.
Shut up. You're such a brat.
Now serving dinner for one.
You are a spoiled brat.
Yeah. Who wants to kiss this guy? That's right, we heat things up, baby, when we're naked.
Got my son his first birthday card.
You missing it?
Yeah, I'm gonna miss it. Dude.
Oh my God.
That's my boy walking. Man.
What are you gonna do?
That's my life.
Miss the cold.
Yeah, just a little.
I've been here since 8:30 in the morning.
It's freaking cold out.
Woo!
We're in Minneapolis and we're loading in. And there was some piss poor planning on somebody's part, so that's why we have to push it a mile and a half in the ice and snow.
Off. I'd be complaining long before they would even think about complaining.
A loading that should have taken a half an hour took an hour and 20 minutes.
A guitar tech is someone that keeps your guitars in tune with one another. It's really important to have, otherwise you'll play out of tune. You know, they're in control of all your equipment. It's a job where when things are going great, you don't ever speak up until something wrong happens.
I love it. Travel all over the world. Play instruments and goof off with your friends. Pretty sweet. And this is out of tune.
Mike is our tour manager. One of the funniest men on the earth.
Can you hold this for a second?
No!
No!
Dude, that is fucking disgusting.
He is somebody that when I have on tour with me, tour just seems to be a whole lot better.
Watch this. No, wait. Smells gone?
He's like painfully honest with people. He hates almost everything.
I wear a brand new pair of socks every day.
Do you?
I don't like to deal with dirty socks, so I throw them in the trash every day.
Wow.
And Mike Leonard hates mayonnaise.
Tim, will you taste that and tell me what that is?
If he sees it, if he hears about it, if you talk about it, if he smells it. Oh, sorry, I forgot.
No, it's some kind of cheese.
And once in a while, it's so much fun to fuck with it.
Okay, cool.
People that tour with rock bands do it because they have the disease, too. It's like once you get in, you just can't stop. It's so fun being on tour. It's a great experience to see the world. It's an educational experience. It's the university of life. I'm going to toast to all road crew is out there. Adam called me and said, hey man, you're not gonna believe this. Green Day wants to take you out on their American Idiot tour.
We were amazed to get a phone call from Green Day's management that the band had chosen Sugar Cult to go over to Japan with Green Day as well, which was such a great honor. I mean, a large part of the reason Tim even picked up a guitar and started writing songs was Green Day.
We're just big, big fans of the band, and then the idea of playing in arenas is unbelievable. I mean, it's every band's dream. It's a totally different kind of thing. We're playing clubs and theaters, and then we were just injected to, you know, an 11-hour plane flight. Next night, 12,000 Japanese fans and Green Day after they've won their Grammy. What happens in Japan stays in Japan.
It's all about trippy food and futuristic Blade Runner science fiction movie style architecture.
Something's wrong. No mustache. Damn it. It is March 19th, and Sugar Cult is in Tokyo, Japan, and we're opening up for Green Day. It's a small tour. You don't play very many cities when you come over here. It usually lasts about maybe a week, tops. And as soon as this is over, we're gonna make a new record. It's really exciting. Everything's so fucking clean and beautiful here. It's amazing. What song? What song are you playing?
Lost in You. And
really?
Yes, Memory. I love it.
Thank you. What's your name?
My name is Miki Ueno.
What?
Hi.
Miki?
Yeah.
Ore wa Sugar Cult no Tim Daze. This is an amazing experience to be in a band and travel like this and come all the way over here. And the fans in Japan freak out. The vibe they feed off of an American rock band is so cool.
They show up at the airport, at the train station. They're bringing the band gifts and homemade things.
Is it for me?
Yeah.
It's a cock sweater.
They must check them in with their tickets and then keep them in a room somewhere and hold them like bowls or something. It's like a gun goes off or something, and you know, all of a sudden there's, you know, hundreds of kids running top speed at the stage.
It's like a different country here.
I've never seen so many Japanese people in my life than right here in Japan.
Yeah. It's weird.
4 minutes.
Japanese fans go crazy at shows. They'll be like, hey, 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 hey. Or they'll, like, you know, you'll see them in unison just doing something and you feed off of that.
Japanese fans, they really behave at the show, even though they're, you know, like jumping around, but they just focus on the show.
Avex Restaurant.
We're going to dinner. Are you hungry?
Yeah.
Goodbye.
The record company owns this restaurant, so it's one of the perks. Instead of paying us, they feed us. We'll take it any day.
Some Kobe beef, and that's lobster. Look at those lobsters, man.
Food is always important if you're me. I love food. It doesn't take much to get past the goalie, which is my mouth.
Right? They fucking nail desserts here, man.
Yeah.
Dude, my mom would love this place.
What is that?
It is. It's like noodle weirdness.
It's really good. It's good.
Dude, you're a little pup.
I'm fat?
Little pup?
Since I'm fat. Dude, now you gave me a complex. I'm gonna go throw up.
You guys wanna race? Those are your little escapes. A lot of times we'll go to meals, you know, pair off, or three or four of us will go, or we'll go as a group, you know, like a big dinner where we all go, just to get away from the venue every night.
Oh my God, dude, it's just fucking move.
I can't do it. I feel sad.
Very, very nice display until it started moving.
This fish is lying there, dying, gasping for air, and they're bringing it out to us, and it's going, like that.
Our person that was with us was saying, oh, this is a very special VIP dish.
It's a great insult to not eat that fish.
That is just, dude, I can't hang with that.
I couldn't do it. That was kind of unnerving.
When you're in Rome, do you like Romans too?
Alright, don't bite me.
I had a bunch of pieces and it was really good. Mix that shit up with wasabi and it's a party. Japan's such a rad place for us to tour because, you know, we don't speak the language and we stick together as a band and we have dinners all the time together. Because all we have is each other over there. Even, to talk to, just to have a conversation in your own language. We're just really, really together.
Staying here, like they specifically asked to stay at this place because they like this place so much.
No, it's because they destroyed the other hotels in Tokyo, so they only can stay here.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
No
Marco,
way.
Tim. Rules. Tim. Marco.
We just finished playing our show in Tokyo with Green Day. 14,500 people. It was awesome.
Man. Oh, dude, this feels so good. Just to be in my underwear, kicking back at a nice hotel, paid for by rock and roll.
Fuck yeah. God. Forget this, Patrick.
Hello.
Oh.
Sorry. It's okay. We scared her.
I would kill for coffee and water.
Coffee and a big bottle of water.
すいません。ですね、ちょっとお水飲み物をお願いしてもよろしいですか？
コーヒーください。
あのルームサービスという形。
コーヒー means coffee and 水 means water.
On this trip, we've kind of been talking about, you know, occasionally one of us will say something like, you know, if we ever take this moment for granted, just punch me in the face, because it really doesn't get better than this.
Day two, Tokyo.
I switched alcohols in the middle of the night. I went from tequila to vodka. And I drank a lot of tequila before I switched to vodka. And then I drank a lot of vodka.
Bouncing off the walls again. Bouncing off the walls again. Bouncing off the walls again.
cool again.
Lexington Queen is a bar in Tokyo that will definitely provide an environment to get you in very bad trouble.
One of the coolest things about being on tour in other countries is when you run into people you know from different bands.
It's like that little drop of a different chemical that changes the chemistry of the situation, and we all kind of lighten up because maybe we're all road burned.
So weird just to be over here and run into people. You know.
I don't know who you were talking to, but I was running into Eastern European supermodels and trying to get them not to run away from me.
This guy came up to us and said, "Someone's trying to get a hold of you. Here's the number. Please call this number." So Marco leaves, you know, from the table, comes back and said, "I gotta get on a plane and fly home. This is huge. I can't miss this."
All right, Anna, Hotel Anna.
Hotel, okay.
I'm so fucked right now. I'm in Tokyo, Japan, and I'm having my baby. Like right now, this is totally crazy.
Like suddenly, like everything faded away. The fact that I was in Japan, the fact that I was in a bar, the fact that I was on tour with Green Day, all of that just like parted. And the only thing, it was like I had one goal, and that was to get home, to meet this baby.
It's just one of those, you know, rock and roll stories where he's out at a bar in Tokyo, you know, drinking Jack Daniels and gets a tap on the shoulder by the bar manager.
The bar manager comes to me, he's like, "You need to call your wife or your girlfriend ASAP." And I'm like, whoa. So I go and I use the phone for Lexington Queen and I call Victoria and she's like, "I'm in the hospital right now, my water broke. I'm not even supposed to be talking on the phone." And so I'm like, well, geez, you know, I will be there as soon as I possibly can. And you know, I just didn't know what to say, but, you know, I just gotta, oh, man, there's these moments in life where you just have to, all of a sudden, be forced to grow up. And I feel like I have one of those moments tonight. I'm like, what shirt do I want to be wearing when I first have my kid?
Best bet out of here, the earliest is Delta, and that's at 2:30 p.m. You'd arrive Monday morning at 8:45 a.m. Right now it's about 10:30 a.m. Sunday morning. As of right now, I mean, I think that's probably your best bet.
Yeah, but that's too risky, dude. That's over 12 hours from now until I leave, and that's 24 hours, dude. There's no way.
I'm gonna bet.
I can't get home in 24 hours. I'm gonna bust my ass. I'm gonna get home, and the baby's already gonna be born. She's never gonna forgive me, and I'm gonna never forgive myself for missing something. Thank you.
Nice day.
All right, man. I'll see you. I'll see you when I get home.
Yeah.
3人でのプレーとなりますが、精一杯やりますので皆さんご声援の方お願いいたします。
So this goes out to our guitar players, Little Baby Kawaii
I'm bouncing off the walls again.
I'm looking like a fool again.
That was rad. Alright, let's
go home now. Let's go home now.
This is London.
My son.
He's basically my newest obsession. I just love this little guy. I was at the Lexington Queen having a drink, and I had to dump the rest of it out and jump in a cab and come home to see you be born. So you owe me a drink one day, okay? I also had to leave a Green Day show. We had one more Green Day show, and I had to leave it to come watch you because you're just that awesome.
About a year and a half ago, Marco and I were out behind the studio, hanging out. I mean, some kind of comment about the palm trees and power lines in California, and it just seemed like everywhere we look, there's this palm trees and mainly just power lines. They're not naturally here, they were all brought here. Being a band and the amount of touring we did on our first record, we were either coming or going to California. The palm trees were either in our rearview mirror or coming towards us as we were coming in and out. Here's this liquor store that you know, you'll see in the art on the album is right there. I found that as long as you're kind of in a comfortable place that's small and you can spend a bunch of time, that usually provides the right kind of atmosphere to make art, really. So this is where we record our record.
I ask myself a lot, like, would I be in the band if I could? I'm a lot happier out of the band sober than in the band drunk.
Post-artist career trauma?
Tim kind of got me sober, and I've said before that I'm really grateful for that. And so, you know, I mean, he might have kicked me out of his band, but he also maybe saved my life, so, you know, it's cool.
You pay your dues to do it because you love it, and you love it just as much, if not more, when you get to where you want to be. I'm getting paid to have this much fun. That's unbelievable.
I think rock and roll is kind of the fountain of youth. It does give you kind of this uninhibited sort of idealistic vision of life that anything is possible. We're all recovering teenagers. We're not grown-ups and adults that are joining the workforce.
I love it. It fills me with vibration that nothing else does. So making another record right now is cool.
Don't ever do what you truly want to do based on the idea of having financial restrictions and to come up with a backup plan for life. My life has been just as satisfying when I was struggling as it is now. I'm living the dream. Yeah.
Peace out.
Memory. The girl's sense of fear.
We are rolling. Rolling, rolling.
Matthew Stanky, guitar tech extraordinaire. Where are you right now?
I'm soccer teacher.
Semi-acoustic vibe.
Hey everybody, we have excellent news about Kenny. His name is Lucas, and he's this big, and he fucking rocks. Everybody go home tonight and hump and make a baby.
As a matter of fact, Tim, I got a fever. And the only prescription is for everyone in Seattle to jump up and fucking down.
Get your feet off the fucking floor.
These are the interesting conversations we have in our rock band. It's Operation Noodle Bar.
Oh, I love animals.
Well, yeah, we played a show.
Yeah, baby.
Sugar.
because he's so sweet, called Sugar Ass.
Your ass is sweet as sugar, baby.
Oh. Hit and run, baby.
Hi, my name's Kenny Livingston, and I have a problem. Here it comes, Trips.
You called it.
Do I look like Paris Hilton?
Yeah. Except even worse.
Even worse.
This is a fucking big show. Look at all the people in the balcony, Marco.
Dude, Lincoln Tunnel is...
You like Cracker Barrel?
Dude, we are so close.
Oh, I love it.
You can reach your hand out and put a Sugar Cult sticker on that wall.
You can break your arm.
Everybody say hello to Becky.
Again. Picking up the pieces of a life you've broken.
Thank you. You guys are f-ing great. Thank you so much. Stitching it
together with the naked run for Sugar Cult.
Mom says practice makes you perfect. Let's go. 1 ESI 2 PN 3 4 5.
Sugar Cult.
Getting loose.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't believe I fell
asleep. Talks waste time.
Just the fact that there was people rocking out and like wearing Sugar Cult shirts and singing along, and it's our second time in this city. The last time we were here was 6 months ago. It just shows that like the word's getting out, which is awesome. Hey, 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 hey. When you make music, it's kind of like having children, and each one of the songs on Start Static is one of our, you know, is one of our offspring. So any chance we get to, you know, it's like you want to take your kids to France to show them the Eiffel Tower. You want to take your kids to Japan, you know, and that's how it is with our songs. We put them all together, and then we want to take them all over the world and play them for as many people as possible. Somebody help me get out of this place. Too many words. Yeah, yeah, hey, hey, yeah, yeah, hey, hey, check, check, yeah, yeah, hey, hey. Give me the keys to get out of
this box. Keep on. This is a brand new song off of our new record that's not out yet. It's called Memory. This may never start. We could fall apart. Not be a memory.
each and every one of you, including you. And we love you in the Mohawk. And we care about you over there. And we care about the devil worshiper back there. And we care about the girls that are working at the Desperados beer tent because they're very sexually attractive.
So I gotta relearn one of our songs because I haven't played it in a long time.
We're gonna do a new song called Cheese for Blade.
Once again, pink prevailed. Dude, my shirt smells so bad right now. It's so bad. I've been wearing it every single night of this tour. Marco had a boy. He cried on the phone. I heard him in the background. He's all, yeah. It was right when I asked him if he was a singer.
I'm starving.
Girls here at this hamburger joint are smoking.
Places never taste so good.
Right now I'm craving a burrito so bad.
No way.
Like little frogs or something. Look at that. Look at that snake. Dude, look at this. It's a snake with pieces of garlic in it. Look at its head, dude. I draw the line at snake. I don't think I could eat a snake.
Way.
A Mexican restaurant. Let's cruise over there for a second. I might get a burrito, and I'm so full right now. You can hardly even hear it here, so loud.
Hello. We're in a taxi cab, playing Sapporo. Camera one, camera two, camera one, camera two, camera one, camera one, camera two, camera one, two, one, two, one, two. I ate so fucking much food today, I'm about to barf. It's the way that he makes you feel, it's the way. Can I be your memory? How do I turn this bad biatch off?
The sign, you'd think it says exit, but it says if you leave through these doors, your testicles will be slayed by a dragon. If you get close to the door, you can actually hear the dragon breathing. Tomorrow we fly home, and when this is the last show of Palm Trees and Power Lines. It's been a busy year and a half. Very busy year and a half. We're playing as a three-piece tonight because Marco flew home when his wife went into labor. I wish we could play with Marco. He's such a great asset to the band.
What's up, design girl?
I think I'm gonna get barbecue wings tonight. Michelle, are you down?
Michelle's down. I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm on the phone with Kelly, my best friend.
Yes.
All the way in California.
Yes.
I'm in person hanging out with my good friend Tim,
and even though I'm hungry, I refuse to get food.
I'm in my PJs.
Do you want to hear a song about it?
Sure.
Kelly. Put Kelly on speakerphone. Okay. Kelly, all the way back home, is keeping my friend Michelle from having wings with me alone. Kelly from back home provides an environment where she's a vice between me and my friend named Michelle, who's not back home. Who's right here next to me, but does not want to participate in life with me. I'm like a fucking rhyming dictionary. Kelly, that was the new one for the next record. It's kind of a work in progress.